Being here, I'm a little bit wiped out from debate prep, debates, and traveling on planes, trains, and automobiles to get here, but it is good to be here. When I thought about running for office, I thought about it long and hard. My wife said, "You're crazy, don't do it. You might get elected." Sure enough, that ended up happening, but I was becoming increasingly frustrated and worried about the country, that we were borrowing so much money. And this is the point I'm trying to get across in the debates. You know, we're borrowing $1 million every minute. So in the next 90 minutes of my speech, $90 million. Now we probably go 90 minutes. But in the next 20 minutes, we'll probably borrow $20 million. And some say, oh, how can we save money? How can we cut costs? You know, it's all essential spending. We hear that from everybody, and that's why we're bankrupt. And if you want to ask yourself whose fault it is it the Republicans' fault or the Democrats' fault, it's both. Because really, they get together, and I tell people it's an unholy alliance and has a secret handshake. That's sort of a joke. But I imagine them at night having a secret handshake, and they have a secret deal just to ruin the country. I don't think that's actually true. I don't think they're doing it on purpose. They just want stuff. And they have a constituency that says, give us some more stuff. So the Democrats want more welfare, they want more domestic spending. But some on the right say, well, we want unlimited military spending. And what happens is they get together and they raise both. And so we just had a deal, and I kept my colleagues awake till 3 a.m, and they're not too happy with me. In fact, I may be the least popular person in Washington right now, because at about 2 a.m, they came by my desk in the Senate and they said, you've had enough to say, right? You're done, right? And I said, well, aren't you obligated to give me 1 more hour? And they were like, yes. So by the rules, I can speak for an entire hour at 2 a.m. And I had taken a nap, so I was ready to go. And it's rare in the Senate that anybody ever listens to a speech. If you ever turn on C-SPAN, it's one senator, one congressman, and if they pan the audience, no one's actually there. Well, I had about 50 grumpy and hacked off and unhappy senators who sat there through my whole speech. It's probably the only time I'll ever have 50 senators listen to me. But they weren't happy about it, but I gave them a lecture. Because the bottom line is, we are destroying the country. We're eating us up from the inside out. And it really is a problem. We have to understand that it's really the fault of both parties. Now, some would say, this is what Rubio was trying to say last night, although I think we got the better of him. What he's trying to say is, well, we have to have more money for the military. How are we going to defend ourselves? Well, I want to defend the country. I've got 3 nephews in the Navy. My dad was in the Air Force. My father-in-law was in the Air Force. My brother-in-law was in the Air Force Academy. We got like 6 people in our family that serve in the military. You think we don't care about the country? We want a strong national defense, but you have to put things in perspective. And the question I want those who want more money, and Rubio's called for $1 trillion more. That's with a T. That's a lot of money. Just where's he going to get it? What's he going to pay for? Is he willing to cut money to get rid of, to pay for this? He put forward an amendment to a bill when we were there on the budget and had a $190 billion increase in military. And I sort of decided to one-up him. I said, okay, why don't we do it? Why don't we cut spending to match it? And he wouldn't vote for the amendment to cut spending. He just thinks we can just increase the money. But if you do that, I think what happens is I just